Bad Times at the El Royale is a new film directed by Drew Goddard. I believe he's the same man who was supposed to bring us the X-Force movies. Man, look at the talent that's involved with this movie. This is an ensemble, and there is a lot of talent in this ensemble. You got Chris Hemsworth, you got John Hamm, you got Jeff Bridges. Dakota Johnson is also in this movie, for whatever that's worth. I'm not sure what you think about her career beyond the 50 Shades movies, but I've always thought the chick had talent. There's this other woman that's in the movie that I can't actually remember her name. It starts with an E, so I'm just going to call her E. She's a black woman, and she's a singer in the movie. I can't remember her name, but man, she was really good too. So Bad Times at the El Royale is this mystery thriller type of movie that takes place exclusively at this hotel called the El Royale. El Royale is kind of a unique hotel because it takes place on both sides of the Nevada and the California border. Half of the hotel literally is on the side of the state where Nevada is, and half of the hotel is also split into California. And so there's a group of people, each one with a different motivation and a different agenda, who converge on this hotel all at once. They all have a bunch of secrets and a bunch of other things that start to spill out over onto each other, and so murder, mayhem, mystery, and a whole bunch of hysterical things that I'm not actually sure were supposed to be hysterical start happening, and so we have a movie. You probably have heard this or are going to hear this from a bunch of other reviewers about this movie, but this movie definitely feels like a Tarantino film. The film is like really blatant in the way that it tries to build off of Tarantino and his style and his aesthetic, and it definitely tries to replicate that for this film. And I gotta say, it's actually a pretty good job of it. To the way that it was shot, to some of the musical choices, to the way they approach some of the characters, to the way that sometimes they transitioned between scenes, you're gonna walk out of the movie probably going, damn, that was a Tarantino film, and I'm not sure how to feel about it. Personally, after thinking about it, I actually kind of gave this movie some respect and some love, because if you're going to emulate anything, I would say emulate something great. And Tarantino is great, and he has some really great movies. And so if you're going to try to make a Tarantino movie, you try to make it the best damn not Tarantino movie that Tarantino would be proud of. Sure, you could also look at that and say it's watered down Tarantino, because even though it's rated R, there's like 50,000 less niggers and a whole bunch less blood porn in this movie, so maybe you might be disappointed walking out. Point is, take anything bad in the world, like take a shitty movie. When's the last time that anybody tried to emulate something shitty? Like, I don't know, the Twilight movies. You know what, on second thought, that's actually a really shitty example, because the Twilight movies are how we got the 50 Shades movies, so just forget I said that. Either way, my point stands, at least they tried to emulate something great, and I would say that most of the time it pays off. An ensemble movie like this, I don't feel like it would have worked half as well if the characters weren't well written and if the acting wasn't up to snuff. Because essentially you have a self-contained thriller that takes place in this hotel where you're trying to find out about these characters. If the ensemble sucks, the movie sucks. That's just movie making 101. Luckily, the ensemble doesn't suck. In fact, I'd probably say that each actor in this movie gave a very strong performance. Dakota Johnson was really good. Her character probably had the most mystery surrounding her to start the movie off. John Hamm was really good. He wasn't in the movie as much as everybody else was in the movie, but I gotta say, John Hamm, when he was in the movie, was hamming it up, no pun intended. I'd probably say Jeff Bridges' performance had the most heartbreak to it. Like, I felt the most for his character once you find out certain things about his past and his backstory. I gotta say, the scene stealer was definitely Chris Hemsworth. Chris Hemsworth was a total asshole in this movie. He was such a creep. He doesn't really show up until, like, the third act of the movie. He's essentially trying to chew the shit out of the scenery, man. He treats every scene like his own personal bubblegum wrapper. He tried to rely on the tried and tested formula of using long single shot takes to fill out the movie and make every scene feel a little bit more suspenseful than it actually is. This movie used that technique a lot, and I gotta say, it was much appreciated by somebody like me who actually pays attention to that type of shit. If there's something I could praise about this movie beyond anything else, it is the level of attention of detail that they put into these characters. I was not expecting these characters to have the layers or the depth that this movie tried to give to them. It doesn't mean that you walk out of the movie giving a shit about everybody that's in this movie, but at the same time, you walk out going, you know what, I can appreciate the effort. Unfortunately, while this movie was somewhat enjoyable, and I did enjoy watching it, it is a very frustrating movie to watch. And the reason why this movie is frustrating to watch is because it is nothing but a bunch of endless scenes with stalled momentum. The way this movie decides to tell its story, it decides to cut it up and focus on each individual character, kind of like chapters in a Tarantino movie. But every time you think you're getting invested in one character and they spend a lot of time with this one character fleshing them out, the movie decides to hit the reset button and go back and show you another character's perspective. This is not a technique that's unique specifically to Tarantino films, but I do feel like in this movie, the way they decided to do it, made the pacing feel all all the way off. This is a 2-hour and 20-minute movie that actually does sometimes feel a little bit longer than 2 hours and 20 minutes, and that's because every time this movie started to engage me and get itself going from a story perspective, it decided to go back and show you another character, and then it decided to go back and show you another character, and that shit got irritating after a while, I'm not gonna lie. There's also at least like 3, maybe even 4 questions that the movie seems like it's hinting at answering that it never actually answers, and so I can't help but walk away from the movie thinking these are like gaping plot holes that the movie doesn't care about. Bottom line is, I kinda sorta enjoy Bad Times at the El Royale. I appreciate what they were going for. I appreciate the ambition and the style that they approached this film with. But the stalled momentum of the script and the story and the characters made it hard for me to really engage in the movie throughout the entire runtime, and some of the plot holes are bigger than Texas. So while I'll say that the movie was somewhat enjoyable, I'm not gonna recommend it highly. I will put it in the golden age for Man of Steel. Alright guys, those are my late thoughts on Bad Times at the El Royale. Tell me in the comment section, what's your favorite Tarantino movie of all time? Please like and subscribe to the Superfan Show, and as always, if you like what you see, tell me how you feel, and stay tuned to hear more from the Man of Steel. Peace!